Good day, everybody. This is going to be a demonstration of the entire esophagus and the accompanying vagus. This is a supine cadaver. I'm standing on the right side. Camera person is also on the right side. So the extent of the esophagus is from the neck to the abdomen. The cervical esophagus is approximately from this level where my instrument is pointing to T1. So that is the cervical esophagus. Then if I were to lift up this, then we have the thoracic esophagus. Thoracic esophagus is from T1 to T10. T1 is the thoracic inlet, T10 is the esophageal hiatus in the diaphragm. It is running in the posterior mediastinum. And then we have the abdominal esophagus, which is a very short segment, but we have pulled it down to make it look a little big. It is from T10 to T11. Initially, the esophagus is situated a little on the right side, and we can see it is located to the right of the descending thoracic aorta. But as it goes down, at the level of diaphragm, it moves a little in front of the aorta, and it moves to the left, and we can see the aorta is moving to the back. So it moves to the left, and this is where it exits through the esophageal hiatus. So therefore, abdominal segment of the esophagus is from T10 to T11. This is only just half an inch. Apart from that, there are a few other points. The cervical portion of the esophagus and the thoracic part of the esophagus does not have any serosal covering, so therefore there is no protection. While the abdominal part of the esophagus is encircled by visceral peritoneum, which is referred to as the serosa. Now we come to the sites of esophageal constrictions. The first constriction is at its origin itself, and that is referred to as the upper esophageal sphincter or the pharyngo-esophageal junction. This constriction is produced by a muscle called the cricopharyngeus muscle, which is the muscle of the pharynx, and that constitutes the upper esophageal sphincter. This constriction is approximately 15 centimeters from the incisor teeth as seen through an esophagoscope. The next constriction is at this complex that we can see here. We can see this is the arch of the aorta. The arch of the aorta, as it goes, it curves posteriorly and behind, and therefore it compresses the esophagus from the side, and we can see it here. It compresses the esophagus on the side here. So this is another constriction, and closely accompanying that constriction is this constriction produced by the bifurcation of the trachea into the left and the right principal bronchus. So these two constrictions together are considered to be approximately at the level of 25 centimeters from the incisor teeth. Aortic arch constriction is from the sides, therefore it is best seen in an anterior-posterior view, while the tracheal bifurcation constriction is more from anterior-posterior, so therefore it is best seen in a lateral view of a barium swallow. This is a barium swallow to show the aortic arch and the left main bronchus constriction of the esophagus. And the third constriction is at the esophageal hiatus, which is at the level of 40 centimeters from the incisor teeth. And this constriction is produced by this structure of the diaphragm. Now, if you were to look closely, we can see this muscle fibers that we see here. This is the right crest of the diaphragm. The right crest of the diaphragm, as it goes, it completely encircles the esophagus and it comes back again. This constitutes the lower esophageal sphincter, and this constitutes the lowest constriction or the diaphragmatic constriction. This is another barium swallow to show the diaphragmatic constriction and a dilatation above that called the phrenic ampulla. So we have seen the two sphincters and we have seen the constrictions. Now let's take a look at the blood supply and the venous drainage. The blood supply of the cervical esophagus is the inferior thyroid artery. This is the thyroid, and the inferior thyroid artery is a branch of the subclavian artery. The venous drainage is to the inferior thyroid vein, which drains into the brachiocephalic vein. The thoracic part of the esophagus, the blood supply is from the descending thoracic aorta, the esophageal branches. And the venous drainage is to this vein here. This is the azygous vein. So this is also part of the systemic circulation because it drains into the superior vena cava. The abdominal part of the esophagus gets a blood supply totally different. This is the celiac trunk, and we can see these branches. This is the left gastric artery. And the esophageal branch of the left gastric artery supplies the abdominal part of the esophagus. And the venous drainage is to the left gastric vein, which drains into the portal vein. So therefore, we have a very important clinical correlation here. The abdominal part of the esophagus belongs to the portal circulation. The rest of the esophagus belongs to the systemic circulation. So in the submucosa of the esophagus at the lower end, there are small microscopic communications, which is not visible in a normal person. And those communications are referred to as the porta systemic communications. In a patient with alcoholic cirrhosis and portal hypertension, these porta systemic communications become dilated. and then they become known as esophageal varices, which we can see through an endoscope, and these can rupture and they can lead to life-threatening hematemesis. This is a dissection specimen from another cadaver to show alcoholic mitronodular cirrhosis of the liver. And this is an esophagoscopic view of the lower of the esophagus to show esophageal varices, which I described just now. The next point which I want to mention to you was about the nerve supply of the esophagus. We have seen this nerve here, and we can see this nerve here. This is the right vagus, and we can see the right vagus is coming down from the neck, and it is going in front of the subclavian artery and is entering into the thorax. It is going behind the hilum of the lung. Similarly, the left vagus, this is the left vagus, and we can see it is coming in the carotid sheath. It goes behind the hilum of the left lung, and below the hilum, it breaks up into a plexus. And we have removed most of the plexus, but we can see some of the fibers of the plexus here. And after that, the left vagus comes anterior, and we can see that here. It is curving anteriorly. And the right vagus goes posterior, and we can see it is going posterior. And both of them exit the thorax through the same hiatus, that's the esophageal hiatus. The left vagus, or the anterior vagus, is the smaller one. It supplies only the anterior part of the stomach, and it supplies the hepatic and the biliary plexus. The right vagus, the posterior vagus, is the larger one, and it supplies up to the midgut. Cervical esophagus and the thoracic esophagus. The cervical esophagus drains into the lower deep cervical nodes, and the thoracic esophagus, it drains into the posterior mediastinal nodes, while the abdominal esophagus, it drains into the celiac nodes. Cancer of the thoracic esophagus and the cervical esophagus, they tend to spread very rapidly because there is no serosal covering. And therefore, cancer of the esophagus is very difficult to treat, and the life expectancy and the prognosis is very poor. The best way to study the esophagus is by means of a barium swallow, followed by esophagoscopy. Another gold standard test for the esophagus is esophageal pressure recording, which is referred to as esophageal manometry, which is required in motility disorders, which I could describe just now. And because there is no serosal covering in the thoracic part of the esophagus, while doing an esophagoscopy, rupture of the esophagus and mediastinitis is a likely possibility. And finally, some other pathologies pertaining to the esophagus. Sometimes there may be a mismatch in the peristaltic constrictions of the esophagus, and that can lead to dysphagia. One such condition is referred to as presbyesophagus, and the other is what is known as diffuse esophageal spasm. They are all because of abnormalities of the sympathetic, parasympathetic supply of the esophagus. So these are some of the points which I wanted to mention to you about the esophagus and the vagus nerve in the cervical region, thoracic region, and the abdominal region. That's all for now. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Davido is the camera person. My MD1 students are my silent spectators. If you have any questions or comments, please mention in the comment section below. Have a nice day.